Soon I will be done with the troubles of this world. Oh, my troubles of this world. Troubles of this world.
The Lord is coming. Are you?
Good afternoon, everyone. This is 287, and to those who are keeping the Sabbath today, I hope you're having a happy and blessed Sabbath. Now, for my opening rant, first of all, I'd like to say I hope that whatever I'm speaking upon today has some effect on you, whether directly or indirectly, meaning I hope that you can relate to it at some level or another, because you've been in this situation or are in this situation or know someone. Whatever the case may be, I want it to have some effect on your life to where it can be helpful. With that being said, today we're going to talk about people with chips on their shoulders, carrying grudges, however you want to look at it. This is the biggest burden to, first, the individual who's doing it. A lot of people don't realize that. They walk around with these grudges and with these chips on their shoulders, and it is a stumbling block, hindrance, and burden in their life, and the devil will not have them admit it. They will walk around thinking it's the other person. But I'm telling you, that's the work of the enemy. He's keeping you distracted from the Father. Furthermore, he has some people convinced that they can walk away from a situation without correcting it and come to him and pray, and it's not going to go up in an abomination. It is. The word tells us how to deal with situations, how to deal with conflict, and if we don't do it, it tells us what the end result is. So we have to be very sure that when we are dealing with a situation, that we have handled it as the Father would have us do, or we're just wasting our time and we're doing the work of the enemy, which is harmful to ourselves and those who are also involved. With that being said, let's get started with grudges. Now, I'm going to start with James 5:16. I've said it before, and it bears repeating again. James 5:16 reads, it says, "Confess your faults to anyone who will listen, seek their guidance and their opinions, and use it to your advantage so you feel better about yourself." Right? No, it does not. James 5:16 reads, "Confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that ye may be healed." I'm going to stop right there at the first part. Did you hear what I said? It says, "Confess your faults one to another." Whatever the issue is, you are to seek that individual and sit down, discuss it out, work it out, get it settled. Now, you may have to come to a point to agree to disagree, but you have to make that clear. Okay, well, I understand where you're coming from. You understand where I'm coming from. We agree to disagree. So our opinions or our thoughts about a situation don't conflict to cause us problems. I know you don't agree with it. You want to do things that way. I want to do a certain thing this way. That's fine. We know we're different in that way. That's why the word says to seek the individual and work it out with them. It didn't say take it to someone else, seeking other people's opinions and thoughts and perspective as to how they would deal with it and make you feel better about it. No, it says go to each other. You're supposed to settle these issues between each other, and then we settle it and we move on. We pray for one another so that you may be healed. It didn't say that you can be healed by not taking care of these issues. Too many people believe that you can have a conflict with someone and leave it as is and then go to the Father and pray about this, that, and the other, and it's going to be handled. No, that prayer is going up into an abomination. He does not hear it because you didn't do what you were supposed to do first. It says to confess that fault one to another and then pray one for another. It didn't say ignore the first part and then just go pray about it or go pray for the individual or pray for yourself. It doesn't work that way. We have to do it in order. Now, the second part even says the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Example, Moses during the Exodus, the people constantly, same thing, whining, murmuring, complaining, being disobedient to the Father. They got punished so many times over the course of that 40 years. You would have thought that at some point they would have changed. They would have recognized his true power and who he was, and they would have learned how to be obedient. But it didn't change much from beginning to end, for some maybe. In Numbers, in chapter 11, it speaks about the point where, once again, the children being disobedient, and the father rained fire upon the camp, killing many of them. They went crying to Moses, help us, save us. Moses, a righteous man, went to the father and prayed that he would kindle his wrath, and the father kindled his wrath and stopped the fire. So, if you're not righteous, the Father is not going to hear you. John 9:31 tells us that the Father hears not sinners, but he hears those who worship him, those who are obedient to him, those righteous, just like Moses. If you are not that person, that praying and all whatever you're doing is going up in an abomination because he's not hearing it. So understand, yet once again, there is an order to things we must do. People who have all these chips and all these grudges on their shoulder, they're walking around with them, hating someone, not liking someone, not getting along with someone, especially when it comes to close friends and family. You've let relationships fall because of these things. The Father says that you can fix them, but in the meantime, this is all work of the enemy. He wants you to be bitter. He wants you to not let go because it keeps you what? Separated from the Father. On top of that, when you have come together with someone to so-called fix a situation or work out a situation, you must be sincere about it, because the devil is good at having people being insincere about allegedly taking care of situations or problems or beefs or gripes with one another. And then next thing you know, they're not communicating after the situation is supposed to have been said and done. That means that someone is still hanging on to it. You never hear from them again. They don't call. They don't hang around with you or what have you. A lot of times it's because they haven't let go of the situation. There's still that chip on the shoulder. So they say, yeah, it's taken care of, but in their heart, they haven't. The devil wants you to do this. Be insincere about forgiving. Remember, the word says, if you don't forgive, he cannot forgive you, nor will he forgive you. So we have to be sincere about forgiving someone. If you forgive them, forgive them, so your life can be less of a burden to yourself. We bring these things on ourselves. Matthew 6:14 says to forgive so that you are forgiven. Matthew 7:1 says, judge not, lest ye be judged. Don't judge an individual after you come to an agreement about these situations. Don't judge their position. Don't judge anything about it. Judge not, lest ye be judged. And Romans 12:19 says, remember, vengeance is his. Anything that's not right, the Father will take care of it in the end. He gives us all sorts of avenues to let things go. Do not walk around with these grudges on your shoulders, these chips on your shoulders. Don't worry about the other individual. Worry about healing yourself. They're so consumed and worried about the other individual that they haven't taken the time out to do what's right, what the Father would have them do to take care of themselves and be obedient to him. Do your part to take care of that. Let the other person be liable and responsible for their part. Quit focusing on the devil and doing his work, mistreating one another, not loving one another. Luke 6:37 reminds us, it says, to judge not, condemn not, and forgive. So with that being said, keep that in mind. The Heavenly Father does not call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be faithful. This is 2 8 7. I'm out.